brother. What's up?
This is a good recording, man.
Yeah,
I
brother,
can
like,
dig it.
Stop right on.
All right, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesday is with my co-host, Sandy Williams, and we're talking about inflation and the economy. And so we've got some callers hanging on from the first half of the show. Let's go to them directly. Cassandra from Middleton. Good morning to you, Cassandra. Thank you for holding on. You say what?
Earl, thanks for taking my call. And Sandy, it's nice to see you in the pilot's co-chair again today. My observation or comment for today is more in line with Gary, who called earlier. Now that Kamala Harris has selected her VP candidate, it is time for her to really sit for interviews. I am concerned that she's only doing campaign speeches at this time. And the last time I looked, it was a couple of days ago, there was not a policy platform on her website. So it's time for her to start talking about her policy position and how she is going to execute them. And that's all I have to say. As far as Tim Walz, I think he's a good choice. He won't do any harm. He doesn't really add to the ticket, but he doesn't subtract from it either. So as far as I'm concerned, it was a safe choice.
Hey Cassandra. Cassandra, let me ask you before you go. Kamala has been in this position going on 3 weeks, and we're calling for her platform. Her platform, again, is going to be the platform of the Democratic Party. We know what that is. She's not going to come in and completely change that platform. I still don't understand. Sandy and I constantly ask the question about what is the Republicans' platform? And all this time, we've been asking more and more about Donald Trump and what his platform is going to be. He has none. And so why is it 3 weeks in you think it's important that Kamala Harris has to deliver
it? I think, Cassandra, we just need to be patient. I'm confident that there will be a great deal of discussion about policy. I think that, quite frankly, the Democratic side will demand that there be discussion by their candidate of policy, because it's quite a policy-driven, I think, politically speaking, I think that the Democratic side is much more policy driven than maybe the Republican side is. So I'm pretty sure we'll get there. It's kind of early in the game, and I'm pretty sure that your request will be granted.
Well, you know, because of the way she entered into the position, and there's only less than 90 days left.
Well, you know,
before the election.
Well, you know, the elections, the elections in most of the developed countries are restricted to 100 days. So we can say in the United States that 90 days is a short period of time. But 90 days, with the amount of spotlight attention that's going to be placed on this, is plenty of time for people to lay out their policies, to garner support, or to make mistakes. I mean, it's plenty of time.
Well, you know what? Not everyone pays attention. Most people, or some voters, they receive their information at the last minute. So they may not have time to read it and also do research on it. But as I said before, she really does need to put some meat on the bone and put out her policy position. Well, thanks a lot for the call.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the call, Cassandra. I appreciate it. The first big first big mistake of her campaign, she should have picked Josh Shapiro. you don't win Pennsylvania, you lose the presidency.
Well, who knows?
That's a comment from the Facebook page where Stephen is commenting. Okay. And you can comment as well on the live stream by heading over to the Earl Ingram Show and Civic Media's Facebook or YouTube feeds to comment along as well.
It's interesting. I think that there's obviously everyone out there has their own opinion about how to run things. I'm pretty sure that this was a very carefully made decision based on lots of information from the public, from polling, from interviews, from all kinds of scientific processes to try and figure out who could be the best candidate. I think that the interesting thing is that there were such a large number of potentially very strong candidates. And, you know, we'll find out, you know, in the long run, we'll find out what would have happened, what the pluses and minuses were.
You know, Sandy, surprising to me, and then we go back to the phone lines, is Donald Trump made a call for his running mate that clearly many people, Republicans, disagree with from the onset, who he clearly had an opportunity to pick some pretty potent guys.
Well, you know, I think the difference is I'm pretty sure, you know, this is just a projection without firsthand knowledge that the process here involved a substantial many people and lots of input. And I think when the news came out about J.D. Vance and the discussion by the people who were close to the campaign, it was sort of laid at the feet of Don Jr.
Yeah, Don
Jr., who is apparently a political expert, had a lot to do with deciding that J.D. Vance was the perfect candidate. So that just sounds to me like it's a lot less carefully analyzed.
All right, let's go to Brendan. Good morning to you, Brendan. You say what?
I just wanted to make three quick points. John Stewart did an interesting interview about inflation, and they do calculate that the corporate greed is about 40% of what we're looking at in the actual inflation. The other thing that people are not calculating into homeowners and inflation is the global warming and the effects these storms are having, and the effect they're having on the insurance industry and what it's costing people to insure homes, insure even automobiles. Because they end up floating around in 8 feet of water. But the only other thing I wanted to say is I'm going to pose the question the other way. Why is Trump backing out of something he already agreed to? I mean, we all know why, but why? What do the Republicans respond to that? Thank you.
All right, Brendan, thank you very much for the call. Let's go to Tom from LA. Good morning to you, Tom. You say what?
Good morning. First off, to Gary. Gary, eggs aren't real good for your cholesterol, so maybe you should cut down on your number of eggs. It sounds like you eat more eggs than anybody I know. Or go buy a couple chickens and put them in the backyard and get your eggs from there. Second, we, the people, ultimately are the government. Kamala Harris's campaign is a people-powered campaign. It is not a corporate campaign. And I am so excited about it. And I just want to say, I don't know where Cassandra has been. I hate to come on here all the time and dispel their lies. But if you listen to a Kamala Harris speech, she talks about childcare, healthcare, taxing the billionaires, rent control, the things that Sandy talks about that we should be talking about for Tom, Dick, and Mary. So I don't know where the heck they're getting it from, but I do want to say one last thing. For CJ, I've donated $50. For Gary, I've donated $50. For Cassandra, I've donated $50. For the guy from Minnesota that calls himself a Democrat rather than being part of the Democratic Party, I have donated $50. I've donated $50 for myself this morning. So I've donated $250 because I am so excited that we actually are getting our democracy back. And we are going to get it through Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. And I cannot be more happy. And I'm so sick of their rain clouds because they got nothing. They got nothing. Hey, we have actually democracy and not an authoritarian dictator. That's why Donald Trump thinks he can say, hey, we're having this debate at such and such time because he's a dictator. He tells people, this is what we're going to do. BS.
Hey, Tom, you got it off your chest? Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for
the call. You know, let's go to Jeannie from Eau Claire. Hey, good morning to you, Jean. You say what? Jean. Okay, so wherever Jean is. So, Sandy, I guess what I'd like to say about all of those things, to keep asking what is, you know, the platform of Kamala Harris, it's the Democratic platform.
Well,
the Democratic platform doesn't change.
Well, I think the Democrats, and I think she will, in fact, do a much better job of discussing the issues than they have in the past, quite frankly. Because I think the Democratic Party has done a lot of the right things, but they haven't done a very good job of explaining what they're doing or why they're doing it or what the impact is, which leaves a vacuum that leaves them subject to being criticized for things that shouldn't be laid in their lap, like the inflation that was the result of the outcome, largely the outcome of the pandemic, the pent-up demand during the pandemic, the war abroad that had the impact on the price of oil and gas, the tariff policy of Trump that disrupted the supply chain that caused a shortage of things in addition to the pandemic. I mean, there are plenty of things to analyze, to explain whatever it is that is negative, okay? I mean, the only thing that Joe Biden did that he could be accused of is passing an infrastructure bill that was a large expenditure bill that involved the employment of a lot of people. We should remember that one of the reasons we didn't have a pandemic we didn't have a recession during the pandemic because we had the government supporting the economy, literally supporting the economy.
You know, Sandy.
And so there were a lot of people without jobs who needed jobs coming out of the pandemic, and there needed to be some stimulus in the economy to make sure that those jobs were ready and waiting for them, and that happened. I mean, Joe Biden and his administration did quite an orderly job of coming out of a pandemic that could have been a serious recession, coming out of it in a manner that involved no recession whatsoever.
844-967-2789 is the number, guys. Hang on the phone line. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host Sandy Williams and you.
Right on. Right on.
All right, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. It's Tuesday with my co-host, Sandy Williams. Let's go right back to the phone lines. Mike from West Bend. Good morning to you, sir. You say what?
Good morning, gentlemen. I think it's a safe pick. I think he's a very articulate speaker. I've listened to him. He's very approachable. And people will like him, and that would give strength for Harris. He's a veteran. He likes to fish trout. He's a bird hunter. He's a reasonable gun advocate, you know, not somebody off the wall. I would have picked Shapiro to get the delegates, but he's a safe pick. Now, they have to work hard, but he's going to balance her better because if he goes against J.D. Vance, who I thought was a terrible pick, people are going to see how approachable and how likable he is.
You know, Mike, it's very well said because, you know, all the things you just said about him would denote him as being an average everyday guy, right? That he appeals to the average everyday guy.
Well, I think he's I think he's a very appealing guy, and I think he actually has the potential to appeal to some of Trump's base because of the kind of person he is and his capacity to talk directly to them.
Hey, Mike.
Yeah, I think economic.
Go ahead quickly.
I just wanted to say one thing. Economically, I think he's pretty stable. He's got a lot of common sense, and that's what both parties need right now is a little common sense.
Hey, Mike, thank you very much for listening, man. Thank you very much for the call. Let's go to Tom from Richland Center. Hey, good morning to you, Tom. You say what?
Yeah, in terms of some common sense, you know, Medicare for All would save families roughly $5,000 a year if they currently pay for insurance, and that would almost double the local economies if you look at it like special rural areas. And what got trashed as a Green New Deal was an idea of having us finds ways to get energy locally. Out here, we could have all our fuel and a lot of our heating and our electricity made from our biomass and biofuels. And that, once again, almost doubles the local economy. 20% of our state economic energy engine goes out of state for bringing in fuel and electricity. And we can make that all here. So it's an example of where the corporate greed is actually keeping us locked into an old system that we don't need anymore. And if you want to get economics to be politically democratic, you got to have it be local. And so there's all kinds of things we can do platform-wise to get rid of that corporate greed.
It's well said, Tom. Sandy, you want to respond to anything?
Well, I think all of that's true. I think that one thing that is happening and that the Biden administration is doing is it has awakened the antitrust division. And the antitrust division is taking on big business. Google, for instance, just recently, yesterday, suffered a decision in court based on an action that was brought. And I think a couple of callers have mentioned this. I do think that ever since Ronald Reagan, we found that Washington has been listening more to K Street with respect to its antitrust policies, rather than taking action to make sure that we have really effective competition in all the markets. If we had really effective competition, for instance, in the grocery industry, we wouldn't have the stickiness in the downward trajectory of prices. Whereas what we found is that prices went up, profits went up for the grocery chains quite a bit, and prices haven't come down as the cost of commodities has come down. And so, you know, this is a policy issue. And which presidential candidate do we think would better carry that policy issue?
Yeah, let's go to Jeannie from McClare. Thank you very much. Good morning to you, Jeannie. You say what?
Good morning, guys. Great callers today. I got to give three
cheers. Yeah, always.
LA Tom and Mike. And boy, just great conversation. And I was going to say comment on that issue, but it seems everything's been covered. But I have relatives who live in Minnesota, and they love the guy. He has honesty and integrity and wonderful things that you would want in a leader. You know, he doesn't lie or, you know, make up stories or go after women. And he works for the benefit of all. And I think he'll be a great vice president. And I think Kamala Harris, who's working for the people also, will make a great president. So I'm looking forward to getting rid of the chaos and seeing that man's face on my television that gives me nightmares every goddamn night, going after women nonstop. It's like, So anyway, these guys, I'm so excited. I'll be able to sleep at night. Thank you, guys, and have
thank
a great
you.
Day.
Thank
Bye-bye.
You very much for the call, as always. You know, Sandy, I guess we can move on to what I wanted to talk about next, and we can kind of get into that a few minutes before we have, you know, go for a short break. But, Sandy, the Middle East, you know, United States has been working for 40 years to try to prevent a regional conflict that I think many Americans may not be aware of and don't understand why it's so critically important that this did not become a regional or does not become a regional conflict. Can you share with your information about the area you've been there?
Well,
why it's so critically important to not allow this to become a regional conflict?
Well, I think regional has a greater possibility that the United States itself becomes involved in it. Okay. I mean, it is from the standpoint of natural resources, as long as oil is important to the world, the Mideast is important to the world from that standpoint. But also, the Mideast is a big population center, and it's an important population center, particularly because Israel's located there. And so I think that the United States has done a pretty effective job, and I think the Mideast itself is not interested in having a regional conflict. I think Iran is a bit of an outlier. One of the reasons it's an outlier is it's not an Arab state, okay? It doesn't speak Arabic naturally. It's got a different language. It's got a different ethnicity. It's always been separate from the Arab states. And in a way, I think the West kind of created the situation in Iran that we did, but back with what we did in 1953 and the Shah, installing the Shah and creating the atmosphere that the Shah created during his tenure, which resulted in the reigns of the Khomeinis ever since. But, I'm actually pretty sure that there will be a much more temperate kind of a situation there than the media. The media likes to, I think, discuss this as if it's always emergent. There's always an emergency pending. And I do think that there will be some reaction by Iran as the result of the conduct on its soil and the assassination of several Iranian or proxy Iranian leaders. But that happened during the Trump administration. Trump had Soleimani executed and assassinated. And there was, in fact, an Iranian response with hundreds of rockets raining down on U.S. Installations in Iraq. But it was a one-time event, and Donald Trump decided to do nothing about it.
All right, 844-967-2789 is the number. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host, Sandy Williams, and you. You know, so- us at 844-967-2789. Text us that same number. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host, Sandy Williams, and you, Sandy, the music.
Well, yeah, this is Take the Money and Run, Steve Miller, but the music today is about money, the stock market. People are, I think, properly interested in what's going on, but maybe overly reactive to what happened yesterday.
You and I had a great conversation off the air that we're going to talk about now, as it relates to military preparedness and how the world is seen by our nation and how the rest of the world sees us and our role in those things. But before we do that, let's go to Chad from Greenfield. Good morning to you, Chad. Thank you for hanging on. You say what?
Hey, what's going on? I haven't been able to call in 2 weeks, but I have two big points I'd really want Sandy to address, and one I'd love for Earl and Sandy to address. Number one, when I called 2 weeks ago, I remember Sandy saying, well, you know, he was making fun of President Trump, saying how people leave his staff and all the turnover. Well, now it comes out that Kamala Harris, her staff has a 92% turnover, the highest ever. The stories of her being so nasty, dropping F-bombs, documented, people having to address her as attorney general. You were saying that you were safer with Biden because he keeps people. Well, what do you say about Kamala Harris with her 92% turnover and how documented and nasty she treats her staffers? And number two, there's nothing to laugh about, Earl.
Chad. We could laugh because what was the turnover like in the Trump administration? in terms of his cabinet?
It was 70.
But what, and what do those, and what do the, and what, how many of the people in the Trump administration one, are endorsing Donald Trump for reelection today? Okay. I think F-bombs, really? Is that what we're going to worry about? Is it because she's a woman that you've brought that up? Because Donald Trump is recorded with F-bombs and much worse.
Sandy, first of all, you're not addressing my comment, obviously. You're not addressing the 92% staff.
Well, I don't know. I don't know that 90. I haven't seen the I haven't seen the statistics that say 92%.
Why don't you just Google it? It was in the Washington Post, and everyone's talking about it. And you won't address it. Well, you were trying to address President Trump's turnover, and Kamala's is way worse. She's doing the F-bombs towards her staff. Donald Trump's not doing it towards his staff.
Go ahead.
Okay, Chad. What's the second issue?
Is there something else?
Okay. Well, first of all, you didn't address the first one.
Well, we will. We will. What's the second?
The second one is, I have said all along that what Kamala Harris and the Democrats have done is a slap in the face towards democracy. She never got one vote. It's stealing the people that voted for her. She never got one vote. She never sold one vote. I mean, she never got a vote.
Well, she did get, actually, she got elected vice president. So how many million votes did that take?
President, there's two different offices. Now, my question is, even Black Lives Matter has come out and said, we're not a country of oligarchs. This is a stolen of our democracy. She's never gotten a vote. I'd like you to address what even Black Lives Matter sees. They've come out and said this is against democracy. You guys say this is all talking points, but even Black Lives Matter says the same thing.
Who
is Black Lives Matter?
Who is the spokesperson for Black Lives Matter? I didn't know they had a spokesperson.
We never knew. That's why the whole thing was a scam, the Black Lives Matter beginning.
If it was all a scam, then why are you saying that we should respond to something they say?
Let me respond to Chad, okay? You can't have your cake and eat it too, okay? You have a candidate who was notorious for firing or losing his cabinet. Important people. Cabinet officials are actually officials and officers of the United States government. Staff is something altogether different. And number two, you want to talk about profanity. I don't think you want to play in that game in terms of discussing personal behavior as between Kamala Harris and Donald Trump, unless you want to make some distinction between men and women. Number one. Number two. I think that the process for selecting the vice president was deemed to be the process used by the Democratic Party, and the Democratic Party they could select a candidate however they chose. The Republican Party was running on the ground that Joe Biden shouldn't be president because he wasn't capable. Joe Biden decided that he didn't have the energy to run after listening to a lot of third parties, including probably the opposition, and decided not to run. So I don't understand this process of wanting your cake and then eating it too. You want to have both sides of the argument. You want to quote Black Lives Matter when it's convenient, but you want to describe Black Lives Matter as a sham. I mean, I just think that we ought to just all be honest. We ought to look at things directly and figure out what we really think. And I think that the data about the staff, Donald Trump, one of his big criticisms, this was immediately before Joe Biden quit, was he said, Joe Biden doesn't fire anybody. You need to fire people to demonstrate the strength of character. Well, maybe Kamala Harris is very demanding and wants things to be accomplished, and things maybe weren't getting accomplished at the rate at which she chose. I'll be very interested to find the data, because I'd be surprised. 92% is a turnover that she might have experienced over a long period of time, okay? I mean, most staff people who go into government aren't in government for a career, and they come in and out of government. I was staffed to the governor of the state of Wisconsin for 2 years. I didn't leave because I didn't like the job that Pat Lucey was doing when I was his legal counsel. I left because I was only going to leave private practice for 2 years. That was my commitment. So I'm just saying, there's just a lot of folly involved with, and this is, I think, groping, okay? I think we ought to find real issues to talk about instead of personality.
Well, Sandy, I'd like to ask Chad, so, you know, you talk as if, you know, the Democrats committed some crime by having Kamala Harris become the nominee. And I remember when Donald Trump, during a Republican, you know, those who were running against Donald Trump, he chose to not even have a debate with any of them. He was not there. Nobody, you guys said nothing about that. And here's the last thing I'd say to you. To say that the Democrats and Kamala Harris is some wide-eyed, you know, kook who is going to mistreat those amongst, you know, who work for her. Why is it an issue with the Republicans? If that's the case, are you concerned about those people who represented Democrats who were a part of Kamala's?
No. Is he concerned about the Republicans who were the part of the Trump administration? I just think that I think we ought to talk about policies. I think we ought to talk about things that actually matter the citizens of the United States, and not about this kind of stuff. Okay?
Well, that's all they have.
And quite frankly, you can talk about how Kamala Harris was selected, but the voters of America are going to have the opportunity to vote her up and down, and so she's going to be subjected to the test of the vote, and whether the Republicans can worry about how the Democrats selected their candidate, but I think the outcome will be determined by the votes of the American public.
I want to ask Chad one last thing. So, Chad, you mean to tell me you think that these two subjects that you brought up are serious subjects that warrant debate and conversation and that can determine whether or not Kamala Harris is qualified to be the president of the United States or whether it disqualifies? So you really think these two things you brought up have some relevance?
Oh, hugely. I'd like to address your question, actually. First of all, Sandy says, well, you know, it's time to talk about policy. Kamala Harris has not taken a question ever since she's been selected. Now, and to answer your question, Earl, about the debates about President Trump. Now, President Trump didn't do a debate, but guess what? We were able to vote for President Trump, and I voted for President Trump, and our vote stands. No one voted for Kamala Harris. Huge difference. The people's will in the Republican Party stood. The people's will in the Democrat Party did not. No one voted for Kamala Harris.
Okay.
I voted for President
Trump. All right. Thank you, Barry.
I'm pretty sure ballots across the state of Wisconsin back in April had both their names on the ballot.
No, that's not true. The candidates who for president in the primaries run solely as, and they choose their vice presidential candidate.
Oh, okay.
But in any case,
thank you for answering that, Sandy. Yeah. That's helpful to know.
So, okay. Brendan, quickly.
Yeah, I just want to say we can already see the attack ads coming out. Let's see, Kamala's husband cheated on his first wife. they're going to go right after the riots in Minnesota on the vice president's pick. But can't get him cheating with a whore or doing anything else like that, so they'll probably go after that. I'm so tired of these people calling with these Newsmax, Fox News talking points that don't mean anything. And as far as policy goes, to Greta and everybody else that's called about the policies, listen to any of her rally, the couple of rallies she's done. She talks about exactly what she wants to do, like you mentioned, Earl. Child care, extended leave for families, affordable medications. You know, I mean, she's talking about this. Plus, it will be a continuation of the Biden policies. Nothing there is going to change. So, you know, good luck, Republicans. You sound like a bunch of scared guys running.
Hey, Brendan, thank you very much for the call. You know, Sandy, you know, it's difficult when you were sitting on a perch 3 weeks ago and you were coming out of the pep rally that you talked about that was the Republican convention. Yeah. I was there. I saw the excitement and the energy that they were experiencing. And they felt so excited about what appeared, and the numbers were going up for Trump and the numbers were going down for Biden.
Well, I just think it's going to be a very interesting 3 months. And I think that 3 months is plenty of time for the American public to digest the differences between these people. Neither one of them is an unknown. Neither one of them represents a blank slate in terms of policy or the analysis of what their policies have been. So I think this is an opportunity for the American public to put their glasses on, read the small print, look carefully at what their options are, and think about what it means to them personally. And we ought to force people, when we talk about it, not just the candidates, but the people we discuss this with, let's talk about policies. Let's not talk about personalities. And I'm sure the Republicans would be not interested in talking about personalities if it put a bright, glaring light on their candidate.
All right, 844-967-2789. As a matter of fact, it was Lindsey Graham this morning who was talking about the fact that Republicans have a problem with personality.
Right.
That's Lindsey Graham. Who was he referring to, Sandy?
Well, I suspect it was a veiled reference.
All right. 844-967-2789 is the number. Hang on, guys. We'll return. He makes his living off of the people's taxes. Bobby Sue, whoa, whoa, she slipped away. Billy Joe caught up to her the very next day. They got the money, hey, you know they got away. They headed down south and they're still running today. So you go on, take the money and run. Go on, take the money and run. What is the last few minutes of the Earl Ingram Show? It flies. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. Sandy, the music.
Money for Nothing was that one, but it's about the money in the stock market. We were talking about that early in the day, and a lot of people were talking about it yesterday, and I'm sure that they'll be talking about it today after the market figures out what happened yesterday.
All right, let's go to Tom from West Dallas. Good morning to you, Tom. You say what?
Hey, good morning. First off, the gentleman was talking about Kamala Harris' staff turnover. The only thing I could find on that whole story when I Googled it was mostly from right-wing Fox News, Washington Post, or whatever. All the right wings were talking about that. I couldn't find anything from Reuters or Associated Press or anything like that. I think it was Gary from Sussex was also talking about the price of Coke and everything. Coke's first quarter profits of this year were $760 million. Profits, $760 million. Kroger quarterly profits are through the roof. It's corporate greed. And he also mentioned the cost of eggs. Eggs are up again because of the bird flu, and the price of feed has gone up, and so that's why we're paying more for this stuff. It's not Biden, it's not Harris. It is corporate greed, them firing, laying off 1,500, 15,000 whatever people, and then buying a whole ton of their stock back so their stockholders can make the money. That's what it's all about, making money for the stockholders, not for us.
Hey, Tom, thank you very much for the call. Let's go to Bill from Oconomowoc. Bill?
Great show. And by the way, we got to move those refrigerators, too. But anyhow, I like your intro. But on Kamala in the upcoming election, finally, Democrats are playing offense, not defense. It's an awful lot of fun. Let's just look at the record. It's real simple. Biden believes in investing America. Trump doesn't. His record speaks for itself. And last but not least, on records, Kamala versus Trump. Kamala doesn't have 34 felonies, and she is a state prosecutor. Enough said on the whole upcoming election. Have a wonderful day, guys.
All right, Bill, thank you very much for the call. You know, Sandy, is Tom still hanging on? No, okay. So Sandy, here's kind of where we are. It's going to be tight. Either way this goes, it's going to be tight. Would you rather be in the position of where the Democrats are now or where the Republicans are?
Well, I think the Democrats have needed in the past to have articulate spokespeople to discuss policies and to force the campaign into the realm of a discussion of policies and the implications of the policies for middle-class America. And I think that that's what they've got now. I do think that both the presidential and vice presidential candidate have demonstrated that they are articulate and they're able to discuss policy. And to bring the campaign down to that issue will be very troublesome for the Republicans because they have not nominated a candidate who is very articulate or capable of talking about policy. And I think that has benefited them in the past because it's allowed them to get elected into office without a policy basis and to continue to demonstrate that when they get elected into office, the main policy they implement is tax reductions. Tax reductions would be not a very good idea in the current economy and in the current circumstance with our fiscal policies.
All right, Dave from Mequon.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for taking my call. I would just respond to Tom in West Dallas. If you look at Intel, they were given over $7 billion of U.S. taxpayer money. They just announced a couple days ago they're going to lay off 15,000 people. So I guess the question I would have for him is, when we say the rich are getting richer, when we're bailing out Microsoft, Intel, these large corporations, I mean, I don't understand why people can't see that. And I understand we want to bring chips over here, but I don't think we have to give hundreds of billions of dollars to companies that are well-established, that are making profits. But that seems to go unnoticed. I don't understand it.
Well, I think the CHIPS Act, Dave, wasn't hundreds of billions. I think the total that was denominated for the production of chips and the development of it was $50 billion. But, and I don't know the extent to which those layoffs end up being the result of any reduction. I think that Intel has built an additional chip manufacturing facility in the United States. And I think that there was a great deal of discussion of the need for the United States to spawn and to nurture the chip industry for the security requirements of the country, not just the economic and competitive issues associated with it. So that I thought that the rationale for the CHIP Act had a lot to do with U.S. security.
All right. Okay, with the fact that they got $7 billion and they're laying off 15,000 people that was just announced 2 days ago.
All right, Dave, we don't have any more time. Thank you very much for the call. Thank everybody who made this show go, Sandy. Welcome back. Always great to have you on. Up next, Jane Madnair, Madnair on the Air with Greg Bach. You've been tuned into the Earl Ingram Show. Thank you, Luke. Always great to have you around, man.
Oh, this was a pleasure.
Yeah.
Calvin will be back tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
So you're gonna be free of me. You no longer have me.
to kick around.
Kick around.
All right. See everybody later.
I should have learned to play them drums. Look at that mama, she got it sticking in the cameraman. Look at her, so Andy's up there. What's that? Hawaiian noises. He's banging on the bongos like a chimpanzee. Oh, that ain't working. That's the way you do it. Get your money for nothing. Get your chicks for free.